that would be it. Okay, so I am going to do a screen share before we kick this off. Oh, hang on. I'm trying to admit people and do a screen share at the same time. I don't know that I can do that. Okay, hang on one second. Let me stop sharing because I'm trying to admit. Okay, admit all. All right. That's coming in. Screen share is coming up. And I'm going to go into the slideshow preview. Can everybody see my screen? We're good to go? Okay, perfect. Hi, Kelly. All right, everybody, Dr. Biberdorf and I met probably close to like a year ago now, and he was an immediate fan of Power Patients app. And so we have developed this amazing relationship so that we can actually start bringing forward to you all clinical trials. And David is a neuro-optometrist. I'll let him go into all of the details of his illustrious career, but he is a down-home good guy, if I may say that. And I'm super excited to have him not only as a colleague, but as a friend. And moving forward, we're reaching out to all sorts of companies to help us bring pilot studies to you all. So with no further ado, David, I am going to let you take it away with what is chronic dry eye. And then at the end, we can talk about the study that we're bringing on.
Well, just to begin with, probably one of the most misdiagnosed or underdiagnosed.
Wait. Who am I? You're on that page.
Oh, who am I? Excuse me. My name is Dave Biberdorf, and it's a German name. I'm from the Midwest. I practice in North Dakota, and it's starting to get warm here, so it's starting to get a little nicer, not quite as nice as other parts of the country, but I started practicing in Rochester, Minnesota for about 3 years. This is where I worked with federal prisoners. And then after 3 years, I came to Grand Forks, North Dakota, and I've been in private practice, but specializing in functional vision problems or problems associated with either developmental problems children or vision problems associated with concussion and head injury. So I've been working in that area primarily in the last 5-10 years. The issues that keeps coming up when we see patients who have had a concussion or head injury is dry eye. And so we thought that this would be an appropriate topic for today. And I thought I'd go over a little bit about what dry eye problems are. It's an inflammation, basically. And the surface of your eye, if you can kind of think of the layers of tissue, the first layer of tissue of the eye is called the cornea. And the cornea is covered by here that touches the cornea is called the mucin layer. And then there's a layer called the aqueous layer. And then the outermost layer of tears is called an oily layer. And these three tears have to be in an exact mix. Otherwise, they don't function very well and they don't cover that eye very well. And when a person has chronic dry eye, not only does vision blur off and on and a person has to blink, but there's this irritation that occurs that can be quite severe. And if it goes long enough with dry eyes go on long enough, it can actually scar the cornea. So there are different conditions that make a person more prone to dry eye due to the atmosphere or the external moisture in the air. Usually in North Dakota, it's when the heat goes on in October until April, that's when patients complain of dry eyes mostly. But we've also seen that there's a relationship with concussion and head injury. So we'll get into that a little bit later. And you can advance the slide. There we go. So these are all the symptoms that we frequently see: redness. The second one being excessive tearing, and this puzzles a lot of people. Why do my eyes water? And when you tell them, oh, your eyes are dry, they go, no, they're watery all the time. and they can't quite get their head around, why would my eyes be watery and dry at the same time? And that's known as the dry eye paradox. And that is, when your eyes are dry, it sends a different signal to the brain that we need to turn on the fire hoses here because we're so dry. And that's why you get this excessive tearing. So the type of tearing that we get when we have dry eyes is a little different than the basal tears. These are tears that come as a reflex, okay? And then, like I said, when you have a poor, unstable tear film, if the mixture of the mucin, aqueous, and oily layers are not in sync with each other, vision will fluctuate, and patients will complain of that generally when they read. And then one of the biggest symptoms is my eyes sting or burn. And it will have a gritty sensation. And when you look at the tissue, we usually put a little dye in a person's tear, and we look at the surface of the eye when we're examining a patient, and you can actually see spots of dryness where cells have actually dried out or desiccated because they haven't received enough moisture during a period of time. And you can advance the slide. Yes, anyone can be affected, but it's usually in patients who are older and frequently found in patients with brain injuries. And the mechanism behind that is not well known. Why would a person with a head injury be more susceptible to dry eye? Is there a sympathetic, parasympathetic function difference? Is there a blink rate difference? Many people think because after a head injury, you tend not to blink as often, that you also are not re-wetting your eye surface, and that can lead to dry eyes. There's also some studies that look at the glands that are functioning after a head injury, and that these glands that help secrete an oily substance in your tears isn't working right either. So this is the main area that Lynn mentioned we're interested in now, is trying to figure out that connection between head injury and dry eye, okay? And how is it, how does it impact the diagnosis? Well, if you don't address that first issue of dry eyes, especially with a person who has head injury, you may be attributing a lot of their other symptoms, difficulty thinking, difficulty reading, to things that are beyond the dry eye, and we have to assess the first symptom or the first potential problem first. It's kind of like if you're driving around town and you didn't realize you had a windshield wiper on your car, you could be complaining of the bad vision that you're getting from driving around your car to other attributes, and here it's, you got to turn on the windshield wiper first. And unfortunately, when we're diagnosing a person with a head injury, many times people forget that that the dry eye needs to be diagnosed first. And again, when a person has dry eye, there seems to be a connection with anxiety and depression, and just an overall negative effect of visual function, reading in particular. Person can't engage in the activities that they like. And so work productivity can be diminished as well. And you can change it again. Okay, so what we are interested in is what mechanisms are, what are the ways that we can enhance tear function? And we're really interested in doing a study with veterans who had had a history of brain injury and are maybe experiencing some visual discomfort. And so Lynn and I have teamed up with a company. The first study that we're hoping to look at is a company that makes a nasal spray, of all things, to enhance tear function. And the mechanism behind that is thought to be through the trigeminal nerve. There's some feeling that maybe the trigeminal nerve may be not functioning well in their eye, and that could be contributing to dry eye. And so there is a nasal spray that somewhat stimulates that trigeminal nerve to create a what's called basal tearing, to get a better tear film functioning, and we're going to be investigating that. So if you know of any veterans who might be interested, who have had in a study, who've had a history of a brain injury, let them know. And we can go to the next one.
Okay, and then, oh, these are just the references. Okay.
Yes, so, okay.
Okay, so that's the, sorry, go ahead.
Do you have some things you wanted to add?
I did. One of the things, first of all, on the study, we're waiting for all the final documents to get signed before we can actually release it. But the company was so honestly impressed / blown away with the volume of chronic dry eye that we saw on our platform. They had no idea. They're an ocular company, an ocular pharmaceutical company. They had no idea that people with brain injuries of all shapes and sizes suffer from this condition. And so the reason veterans were first chosen was because of a personal relationship that the company has with the veteran population. However, they promised that they would expand this into all brain injury aspects. And that's the bigger deal. This is a very small pilot study to identify the trends to better design a full blown clinical trial. And that's the important part. So that's why, even though we say this one is for veterans, I think it's important to indicate that we're really going to expand this out to all people. And go ahead.
Well, the reason we got interested in this is this is a new product that just came out around Christmas time. And a pharmaceutical rep brought me some samples. And I thought about this, and at the time I was thinking about the trigeminal nerve, and I was looking at the mechanism of action. And I said, gee, I'm going to try it out on some of my brain injured patients who are getting chronic migraines and chronic dry eye. I'm just going to hand it out as an off-label thing to see what happens. And I had a couple of them come back and say, oh my goodness, I've never, my eyes haven't felt so good in a long time. I can read again, and my headaches are actually going away. So we went ahead, and this is the product, and basically you just kind of squirt it toward the outer part of your nostril. You do it twice a day, and the chemical behind this is actually what's called Chantix that they've used for anti-smoking. It's a small amount of Chantix that's in this formula, and for some reason it seems to target that trigeminal nerve, which then stimulates tear function. And so that's where we're at, but it may have some other interesting advantages over other dry eye treatments, in that it could affect things like headache and other visual functions besides just the dry eye.
And Dave, can you expand? Because I had no idea where the trigeminal nerve was until we started this whole thing. So, and does it relate to the cranial nerve, so that people can kind of understand that as well?
Yeah, the trigeminal nerve is a cranial nerve. It has three branches, one to the jaw, one to the upper palate, and then one to the eyes and the lids. And it's that latter one that is a stimulant for, let's say, reflex tearing and things of that nature, and pain. So any pain that you might have, let's say you got something in your eye, that would be a function of the trigeminal nerve. And it seems to have, the trigeminal nerve is tied in with parasympathetic and sympathetic, the fight or flight response. And what we know about head injury is it tends to diminish the parasympathetic system, and head injuries seem to accentuate the sympathetic drive. And patients with head injuries tend to be reflexly more sensitive to things like visually sensitive. So they have a lot of discomfort and even dryness. And so they seem to be hypersensitive. And what we're trying to do is calm that brain down. And this might be one way of rejuvenating their tear film, but also calming that brain down. It is just one of the theories that we have.
And one of the other, I think, important aspects of this study to note is, I'm always very cautious about drug therapies in any way, shape, or form, right? It's always about being fully informed as a patient that you make a decision best for you yourself. The adverse events are honestly minimal. They were sneezing. I think one person did experience a transient headache, but it dissipated very, very quickly. And so it was almost benign, you know, to see what was actually happening for the people in the FDA regulated studies for just regular dry eye. Now, what's interesting, they cannot go back to the data that they have and say who in this study had a head injury. I mean, if they had asked that question up front, they wouldn't have to do this. But this is what the essence of what we're doing with you all to make sure that all of this information is collected and we move forward with it. Second, it is in less than 30 days. I think it was like 2 weeks. We actually look at an actual outcome is a noticeable change in the person's quality of life. So this study in particular is only 28 days long. You're done. And it doesn't get any better. So is there, it doesn't. Yeah. The only better part would be is if we could do it all telehealth, but not yet. Yeah. But is there anything else that you wanted to add about the AEs before I ask people if they'd like to ask any direct questions?
No, I'm open for any questions. Again, there's a ton of different products out there, ways of treating dry eye. We think this is a unique one in that because it seems to trigger trigeminal nerve function, that we think it might be a unique function that other products do not have.
Actually, can we speak a little bit to quote competitors? Like, so in my immediate family, David knows about my two daughters and he knows about Brian, and all of them have had either one, Natalie, the one doozy, and the others have had multiple head injuries. And it was ironic because in Natalie's case, she's the one with no tear production whatsoever and sandpaper like eyes. She wanted to close her eyes and never open them. Brian, on the other hand, he's the one who continually waters all day long. And he got the opportunity to meet Dr. Biberdorf as well. And he's like, I thought Lynn was crazy when she was telling me these things, you know? So they're all very interested in getting on board with this because their quality of life is terrible. But let's speak to a little bit, because Brian does drops 24/7, as does Natalie, every kind of drop imaginable. So besides drops, let's talk about the other options people may have.
Well, clinicians have kind of a regimen that each clinician has their own little regimen of things that they go through. And the first line of treatment, just about every eye doctor that you can think of, the first line of treatment is over-the-counter artificial tears. And there's a variety of different formulas that are out there, but that's usually the first line of attack. But when you start using these artificial tears more than four times a day, let's say, patients get kind of annoyed. And so the next lines of treatment are what we look for. So I'm going to show you some of the things that I do as a clinician to help with tear function in a non-prescription and then a prescription form. There are certain glands of your lids. You remember I said there are three types of tears, and one set of tears is an oily layer that keeps your tears from dehydrating or evaporating. And this oily layers of tears comes from these glands right along your lashes on the upper lid and lower lid. They're called meibomian glands. And these meibomian glands have a tendency to clog up or not function very well, especially in cold weather and as you get older. And so there aren't very good products to get these to function better, but there have been some studies that have looked at heating them and pressing them or compressing them to get this oily substance to release from these glands and get out into your tear film. But it's hard to do repetitively. You can go to a center that has an expensive piece of equipment that can compress them and heat them. And then you usually have to do that every few months. But one easy way to get these glands by your lids to function better is something called a brooder mask. These are just little silicone beads that are in little pouches, and you pop this in the microwave for 15 seconds, and then you lay down for 5 minutes with these on your eyes, and it helps warm up these meibomian glands, get them to release this waxy material that has collected in these glands, and disperse into your tears. And if you do that every day for several weeks, you will find that there's some improvement in your overall tear function. So that's usually my first step after artificial tears to try to get the tears to function better. Well, let's say we're not very successful with that and we need a prescription. There are new products out there that help with that. One product that you have seen on television advertised, it's called Restasis. Restasis is a cyclosporin ophthalmic emulsion that comes in a little tube, and you use it twice a day. You put one drop in each eye. It takes about a month to work. Many doctors will use a steroid eye drop in addition to this to get your tears to produce more of what they have, more of the aqueous layer of tears. So that is usually the second choice, or the first prescription choice that most physicians will use, or eye doctors will use. Another product that came out several years later, it was called Xiidra. You see this one advertised a lot on television. It's a little different mechanism of action, but both of these drops have anti-inflammatory properties. And that's the biggest mechanism of, that's what separates it from just an artificial tear, is its anti-inflammatory properties, okay? And then I think I told you just recently, this nasal spray that's come out, that's a whole different mechanism of action to give you more basal tears. So those are the three new prescriptions that are being used that are somewhat effective and have shown some efficacy in treating this dry eye problem.
And what's really interesting to point out is you had at the very beginning explained to us all the mixture of these three unique tears have to be in a homeostasis type, you know, a balanced state in order to have a healthy tear production of your eye. And unfortunately, without tracking symptoms, honestly, nobody knows what to prescribe, right? So this is why it's so important to pull in the app and Sally and go, okay, well, I tried it and this is what happened. And maybe it gets better, maybe it doesn't, but this is the relationship that we're trying to encourage people to have with their app, their data, and their doctors.
Now, there is a connection that a cluster of dry eye that's related to patients who have migraines and patients who have light sensitivity. And it just so happens that patients with brain injury also have a higher incidence of migraine and light sensitivity and the dry eye. So this triad of having three problems clustered with head injury has got us intrigued that, hey, maybe there's something some other mechanism that's going on here that may be contributing to all of these. And by getting at least one of them solved, get the tear film solved, we may be reducing migraines even, or reducing photosensitivity or light sensitivity. So all these questions still have to be answered.
Yep. And I echo the whole light sensitivity. Alex, my other daughter, she is still experiencing significant light sensitivity where neurofatigue immediately hits her and she goes out, and she was here for the wedding. She went out in the bright sun. She almost fell asleep within 10, 15 minutes standing out during the rehearsals. And so, it tells me that the kind of vision therapy she had was not sufficient. She needs to go into a different layer because of that. But we do need to get her tested for dry eye as well too. So any idea if regular allergens are going to exacerbate this condition?
Yeah, when you have an insufficient tear film, or if your tears don't sustain a good protective coating over the cornea, any allergen is more apt to affect you. So just getting rid of dry eye will enhance your ability to withstand allergies. So sometimes, instead of prescribing this eye drop for allergies, or having patients take the Benadryls and all this other stuff sometimes just getting rid of the dry eye allows a person not to have the itchiness that's associated with, because you have a better tear film. So oftentimes we can reduce the need for the antihistamine or lessen its use just by getting the tear film in better production.
Okay. One more question. Nobody has put anything in the chat yet. One more question that I can think of is, what about patients with strokes or other neurological conditions? We've been focusing on TBI, but what about other kinds of brain injury folks?
You know, I think you're going to be seeing the same thing that we see with head injury. One thing that I think we're seeing already is with a stroke or other neurological issues like Parkinson's disease and things of that nature, there is a reduced blink rate that they don't, patients do not blink as often. If you don't blink as often, if the windshield wipers aren't moving, your eyes are more susceptible to dry out. Okay. And so I think that's going to be an important thing too, that even though our study is going to be mostly TBI, I think you're going to see the same thing beneficial for other neurological disorders.
Okay. Brandon. Hi, Brandon. He just popped in a question. Brandon, I'm not quite sure I understand. What about people with TBIs that affected their eyes? Do you want to expand upon that, Brandon? Yes. Do you want to come off mute? I know you're not shy, Brandon.
Yes.
There you are.
I would like to come off mute. I'm right here. Yes. I was wondering about TBIs and how they affect the eyes. And like my eye, for example, if you can see it, it is much smaller on the right side than the left side because they have surgically altered it to make it closable.
Yes.
Because my right side of my face is completely, it doesn't work anymore.
Right.
And so I was wondering what you thought about this issue that I have, and if it's solvable or if it's just something that I'll have to deal with for the rest of my life or what.
Brandon, just looking at you, I can see that the function in this right side is much like what we call Bell's palsy.
Yeah, exactly.
And so you have this reduced. And what we know from Bell's palsy is because the motor function of the lid not completely closing, it's very much more prone to dry eye in that side. So what they did was quite interesting. They made the aperture smaller so it would be easier to close, which is great. I like this idea.
Yeah.
But you probably need to lubricate that eye more frequently. Are you using, may I ask if you are using an overnight ointment? Like you put a little petrolatum ointment or something in your tears to keep it from drying out at night?
I am not, but I am making sure to close my eyes with my hands.
Yeah.
So that it stays closed for the entire evening. So it moistens up that way.
That good. Yeah, I was just going to say, they call that exposure keratitis, meaning when you cannot close your lid, then it's exposed. You don't have any tear covering it. And that can be, that can really damage that cornea and cause infections and things like that. So it sounds like you're doing exactly the right thing. And as long as you don't have to put ointment, great. If you don't have to put ointment in there at bedtime, that's great.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, whether or not some of these other products are necessary, some of these new drugs, who knows? But it sounds good. And a person sometimes can tell when their eye is getting dry because the vision starts getting poor out of that eye. So,
Okey-doke.
Okay.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, no, it sounds good.
Naja asked, yes, Naja, you will get the slides and the recording after I post the recording. If you're with and Pam has to leave. Bye, Pam. Yeah, we're staying on task today simply because Dave does have an emergency patient. But yes, the slides will be posted with the recording on the website, and I'll send out an email so that everybody knows they can get it. Najah, if you need it for your brain injury group, Dave, would it be okay if we shared the slides?
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. As you can see, both Lynn and I are excited about the visual system and head injury because we think it's been very much neglected. It's a huge neglected mm-hmm. area. And the first part of the visual system is the tear film. And so that's what we're tackling. But we're both passionate about it. And please share this information with anyone who would like.
Yeah. Right. And we do have another study that we're working on too. We'll give everybody a teaser. So Najah, contact me if you want the direct slides as well, and I'll get those to you. And then again, everything will get posted probably tomorrow because I have a tight schedule today. But the other study, we are looking at that parasympathetic system through a nutritional supplement as well. And that one is even much more broad scoped, I would say, wouldn't you, Dave, in terms of that holistic, not a specific problem. And I think maybe one other thing, is there a checklist maybe we should send people to say, hey, if you go through this checklist, you answer one or two or three, I don't know, maybe ask your doctor about dry eye. Do we have anything like that?
I have, there's a wonderful checklist that I believe looks at seven different entities of the visual system, from clarity of vision to dry eye to functional reading abilities and things of that nature to light sensitivity. And it's called the Brain Injury Vision Symptom Survey. I will send Lynn a link to it and she can maybe give the two, but it's a nice little checklist. And if you ever go to your eye doctor or any physician and you fill this out, it's wonderful because it shows you what areas may be still hindering your performance and where the eye doctor should concentrate their energy on improving that performance.
Mm-hmm. And we actually have that, and we compared it to Sally. We have more questions in Sally than on that, but if there's something specific in the BIBSS, I think I have that right. You can always add it as an other category if you wanted to track those directly. So I will also share that as well too. All right. Great. If there's no other questions, group, I will check one more time. Just again, in keeping with the emergency situation. Normally we do go on for quite a good bit, but if there's no other questions, I am going to say thank you so much. And thank you everybody for joining. And if you have any questions, email them to me and I'll forward them to Dave and put you all in contact.
Wonderful.
All right. Thanks
nice
everybody.
Okay. Yep. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Guys.